Do you have an idea what we're going to talk about this morning?
Gifts.
You got it. We're going to talk about gifts this morning. And some of us may say, well, you know, this is kind of a, it's just a little picture, it's just a whatever, I'm not into this or whatever. But I think we sometimes need something tactile. Sometimes I think we need something that, okay, let me have something physical, something that I can look at and see that prompts memory. And so keep this, don't put it away yet, keep it out, because you're going to use it just a little bit later this week, this day, this morning. And so we're going to look at this, gifts this morning, and we're going to talk this morning about the gifts of Christmas. How many of you, let's talk about the natural first, how many of you have done all of your Christmas shopping? All your gifts are bought, everything's wrapped, you've got them under the tree, you've given them to everybody. Yes?
Nobody.
No. I was working all day yesterday preparing for today, and in the late afternoon, I took a break, and I thought, every once in a while, I would try to get away from the computer. I thought, well, let me stop for a little while, and I wrapped a few gifts, and, you know, of course, it was chaos, because there was paper, and there were ribbons everywhere, and then I got back to work again, so I started wrapping some, but I still have a lot of gift preparation to do as well. But when we come to Christmas, as we know, Christmas is a time when there is a focus on gifts, and we do give gifts and we receive gifts as well. And as Christians, we know what people who are not Christians don't know. And we know that the reason we give gifts is because of what we read in the Bible, and because of Jesus, and because of the things that we see related to the first Christmas and the Christmas story. I want us to look at this morning. So we want to look at the gifts of Christmas this morning. Hope you can see it okay. And as we look at the gifts of Christmas, I want us to think of the most obvious gifts of Christmas, okay? Let's get a little bit of feedback this morning. The most obvious ones. What are the ones that you think of when you think of the gifts related to Christmas? What do you think of? Anybody? This is an easy one. Gold. Okay, from who gave the gift of gold? Some of the wise men, okay? Somebody else? Frankincense, okay, also from the wise men. What else? I hear people whispering, they're not quite sure how to pronounce it. Myrrh, okay. Also a type of incense, in a way, a type of fragrance as well. Any other gifts related to Christmas? You can think about it in different ways if you'd like to. I heard somebody say it.
Jesus.
Jesus. We think of Jesus when we think of the gifts of Christmas, and Jesus is the gift of Christmas, and he is the only reason. He is the only reason, and the primary reason that we give gifts and that we receive gifts at Christmas. And so I want us to begin with the gift of Jesus this morning, and then we're going to look at some other things as well. If you would like to, you can take some notes on the back, but I think you may already have an idea of what's coming a little bit later this morning, because I'm going to ask you at some point, what gifts are you going to bring? I went ahead and told you the end of the story, okay? So if you don't have a pen, you can look around you, because I'm going to ask you, what gifts, if you were bringing gifts to Jesus this Christmas, what gift would you bring? So just be thinking about that and let the Holy Spirit start speaking to you this morning. But I want us to begin with the gift of Jesus this morning. This is very familiar territory to all of us. These verses are verses that most of us know very, very well. But it's a good reminder as we think again about Jesus, the gift of Christmas. And he's the first one that we think of. So let's look at a verse that we know so very well from the Old Testament. You see, God planned for Jesus to come from the very beginning. The Bible says that Jesus was slain from the foundations of the world. From the beginning of time, God planned for Jesus to come. God planned to give Jesus. And so we look at Isaiah 9:6. By the way, if we need French translation, do we need translation? Yes? No? Yes. Hang on just a minute. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Kim. Wait just a minute. But let's go ahead and look at this as they're getting that ready. Shall we read this one? This is a song that we sing. These are verses that we know so very well. Shall we read it together? For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. That's from Isaiah 9:6, this wonderful prophecy hundreds of years before Jesus came to earth. I want you to look at this, though, just a minute, and we're going to look at about five verses about Jesus as the gift. There are many, many more than this, but start thinking about it and let the Holy Spirit start speaking to you this morning as well. Because when we look at this, a son is given to us, the government will rest on his shoulders. Let me ask you something. Usually, when we think of rulers of the earth, when we think of kings, when we think of somebody mighty who's over all, or a prince, or someone who takes the reins of power in a country or in a region or in a world, we never think of that person as a gift, do we? Usually, that type of person in the past, that type of person would come to power perhaps through violence, or that person would come by getting rid of his enemies, or that person would inherit from his father before him. And it would be something that the people or his subjects had no choice in. That would have been true at that time. But I want us to see this morning that when Jesus came in all of these wonderful titles, he didn't come through violence, he did not come through force, he did not come through dominion, but he came to us first in prophecy as a gift, as a gift. God could have sent Jesus in any way he wanted to. He could have. He's God. And God could have said, my son is coming to earth and he is going to be king and you will obey him. He could have done that, but he did not. Instead, he said, I give my son as a gift, as a gift. The government will rest on his shoulders. That's not a picture that we usually think of, is it? Usually we think of the government, he holds the power. But here we have this beautiful picture of someone who takes the burden of government upon him. And that tells us about Jesus, one who is a wonderful counselor, not somebody who tells everybody what to do, right? How many of you come from countries where the leader or the president or the king is the one that says, this is how it will be, and that's how it is? They don't, it's true, right?
Yeah.
They don't get advice from anybody. They tell people what to do, right? But our Jesus, our gift, is a wonderful counselor. Think about that. One who has come to walk alongside us and to counsel us and to lead us. The mighty God, the everlasting Father, and a prince not of war, but of peace. But of peace. This is the gift of Jesus to us this morning. You know, we sometimes read Isaiah 9:6 and we could quote it, couldn't we? We could sing it and we just kind of go shoo, and we go, just keep on going right by it. By the way, if we need to change anything around, we can change it around if we need to, okay? Give us a little time. We're trying to get set up. We'll get it set up. We'll keep going. So here we see this gift of Jesus, but I don't want us to stop there. Let's move then to the New Testament. We read it this morning, John 3:16 and 17. Here we find more about the gift. For God loved the world so much, that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. Stop right there just a minute, and I want you to think of something as you think of that. God loved the world so much that he gave his one and only Son. When we give precious gifts, and when we give special gifts, we give them because the recipient is worth something to us, right? We really love that person. We give the best gifts to those that we love the most, don't we? We give the most precious gift to the one that we value the most. And God looked at you, and God looked at me before we were Christians, when we hated God. You may have been an adulterer. I don't know. There may have been a murderer in our group. I don't know. because we could be anything without God, couldn't we? We could have been thieves. We could have been, who knows what we were. You can be and I can be anything without the grace of God. And he looked at us in that way and he said, I love you so much. I'm going to give you the best I have. You are worth it to me. And that's the gift of Jesus. God sent his Son into the world not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. Now, people who aren't Christians don't know that very well, do they? They think God's judging them all the time, don't they? They think God's condemning them all the time, don't they? They think, oh, I don't want to know. I don't want to have anything to do with God because God is judging. God's condemning. God is, I don't want that. But the Bible tells us something that's very, very different. And the Bible tells us that he is not condemning, but he has come to save. And this is the gift of Jesus. Let's keep on going. The same earthly author of John is also the author of the letter of 1 John. Let's read 1 John from chapter 4, 9, and 10. And this, let's put it together. Look at this, how wonderful this is. God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. John keeps the same theme, doesn't he? And this tells us more about the gift of Jesus. Let's not stop there. What does Paul say about the gift of Jesus? Romans 8, 32. Since he did not spare even his own Son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give us everything else? Don't you love that? And here's this beautiful picture. Because God has given us Jesus, everything else is ours too, because it's all in Jesus. He'll give us everything. He'll give us everything. It's all wrapped up in Jesus. And so we sometimes worry, we say, well, I'm afraid if I follow God, I won't get this, or I won't be able to do this, or I won't have this. My life will be less. I will lack because of Jesus. But the Bible tells us something very, very different. Will he not give us everything else, all that is needed? He will. But let's not stop there. Here's one of my favorites. Colossians 2, 2 and 3. And Paul is writing about Christians, and he says, I want them to have complete confidence that they understand God's mysterious plan. What is God's plan? God has only one plan, by the way. What is God's plan? What is it? Are you awake? You're awake? What is God's plan? Well, let's use the Bible. What's God's plan? Christ himself. Easy answer. That was not a trick question, okay? It's not a trick question. What is God's plan? It's Christ. It's Christ himself. And then here in Colossians 2, chapter 2, verse 3, in him lie hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I love this, and I want you to think about this for just a minute. Think of Jesus. In him are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. In him is everything of God's plan. In him is all that God gives us. Jesus is a gift that keeps on giving, right? How many of you think you know Jesus fairly well? I think I do. I do. I've been a Christian a long time. You do, Philip?
Yes.
Guess what? There's still a lot that you don't know about Jesus. You're going to find out more as you keep walking with him. I am too. I think I know a lot about Jesus. But do you know what? All the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hidden in him. And that tells me there's a lot more to know about this gift of Jesus, right?
Yes.
There's a lot more to know. So keep walking with him. Keep walking with him. And you know what? Tomorrow will come and the next day will come. And as you walk with God, you will discover new treasures and new blessings, and you'll find new things, and there will be joy overflowing as you walk with Jesus. Why? Because in him are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. How many of you have ever played that Christmas game before? And especially when you were young and you didn't know it, you know, your parents or maybe somebody else, they had a gift, but they wrapped it up in a box. and then they put it in another box, and they wrapped that box, and then they put it in another box, and they wrapped that one, and they wrapped that one, and then they gave it to you, especially when you were a child, and maybe here was this box this big, and you thought, wow, I've hit the jackpot. And you open it up, and it was just another box, right? Until you finally got to. Jesus is not like that, although there will be an unwrapping and a knowing of Jesus as our gift, but there will always be something new to discover in Him. Don't get bored in your Christian life. If you're getting bored in your Christian life, you know what I would say to you? I would say, get to know Jesus a little bit better. Spend a little more time with Him. Dig into the Word of God, and you will find in Him all the treasures of heaven, all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And then 2 Corinthians 9:15, and I've given you about six different translations of it. Paul overflows with thanksgiving at this point. And what does he say? Thank God for this gift too wonderful for words. And then or in another translation, thank God for His Son, His gift too wonderful for words. Thank God for this gift, His gift. No language can praise it enough. Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift, His inexpressible gift. Thanks be to God for His gift beyond telling. Let me tell you something about this verse. Do you know when Paul came? Now, Paul was a really smart man, very highly educated. Paul was probably a genius in the natural. But beyond that, Paul also had great depths of wisdom and understanding in the Lord, revelation from God. But do you know what happens when Paul comes to this verse and he wants to talk about the gift of Jesus? Do you know what happens when he comes right here? This expression, too wonderful for words, no language can praise it, indescribable, inexpressible, His gift beyond telling. Do you know what Paul did right there? Paul made up a word. He made up a word. It is found nowhere else in the Bible, and apparently, before this time, it was not found in Greek literature before this time. How about that? Paul just made it, he said, I can't even describe Jesus. He's so wonderful. And he used a word, people could understand the word because he put parts together, but it was a word, he brought together a word and made it up to try to describe Jesus, this wonderful gift. And he said, he can't be described. It's too wonderful. He's too wonderful for words. Isn't that a wonderful picture of Jesus? Isn't that a wonderful picture? If I were to ask you today, what could you tell me about Jesus? You could tell me something, couldn't you? But let's say that tomorrow you keep walking with God and you go through other circumstances. And I came to you again and I said, tell me about Jesus. You know what? You would tell me something else. Or you might walk through a valley of deep darkness. And I would say, tell me about Jesus. And you might say to me, He's my light, and He's my only hope. Or you might go through a time of storm, and I'd say, tell me about Jesus. And you know what you might say? You might say, oh, he's my shelter. He's my only still place in this storm. Or you might go through a time when everything around you is shaking, and I would say, tell me about Jesus. And you would say, He's a rock, and I'm standing on Him, and He's the only thing that's keeping me from falling. Or you would go through a time of great need, and I would say, tell me about Jesus. And you know what you'd say? You would say, He provides what I need. This is the Jesus that we're talking about this day. This is the Jesus that is indescribable. This is Jesus, the gift that is beyond expressing and beyond words. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? This is the Jesus who is our gift. He really is. He really is. And you will find more about Him as you walk with Him day by day by day. In times of stress, and you know what? We all have stress, don't we? I will say, tell me about Jesus. And you know what Jesus will be to you? You will say, He is my grace in this time of stress. In a time of pressure, he is my patience. In a time of testing, oh, he's my endurance. He is all of these things. This is Jesus to us. In a time of sickness, he is my only health and my only strength. This is Jesus. Amen? Amen. Amen. And that is why Jesus is the gift of Christmas. He's the gift of Christmas. But I don't want us to stop there this morning. I want us to go a little bit further and want us to look at the gifts of Mary and Joseph. Now, this morning, you might say, hey, wait a minute. Mary and Joseph didn't give any gifts to Jesus. They were his parents. But I want to say to you this morning, I think that Mary and Joseph gave gifts to Jesus as well. Let's look at them, shall we? And let's start with Mary. And I think this is a lot less obvious, but to me, and I don't want to stretch too far, I really don't, but I think this is something that we can look at this morning. And I want us to look at this, and let's look first at Mary. This is from the Christmas story that we normally read, Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 32. I've cut out part of it because I want to shorten it for the purposes of our time. God sends Gabriel, the angel Gabriel, to Nazareth. This is in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. We know this part so well, don't we? She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph. Now, in case you don't know it, you may know already, engagements then are not the same as engagements now. You know, one time when I was a young person, I knew a young woman who was very, very beautiful. She was a pastor's daughter. She was very beautiful on the outside. I'm sorry to say she wasn't quite as beautiful on the inside. But she was really beautiful. Big blue eyes, long blonde hair, and all of the guys loved her. They liked her so very much. And you know what? She liked them too. And when I got to know her, do you know what I found out? I found out that she had been engaged, guess how many times? She'd been engaged 5 times, and she had broken engagements 5 times. I'm sure she's married now with children, but at the time that I knew her, she'd been engaged and she had broken the engagement 5 times. But engagements in those days were not like the engagement, like an engagement today. And if you were engaged to be married, it was the same as marriage. It really was. It was the same as marriage, except you and your fiancé did not sleep together, so there was no physical relationship. But the commitment and everything else was the same as marriage. And so she's engaged to be married. Gabriel appears, and he says, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." She's confused and disturbed. Mary's trying to figure out, what does this angel mean? And the angel says, "Don't be afraid." Aren't you glad that he starts with the good news? Okay, or the best news. Don't be afraid, because the news that's coming next is going to be big news indeed. He says, "You found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you'll name him Jesus." Jesus is the New Testament name. What is the Old Testament name for Jesus? Joshua. Joshua. Joshua in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew, Jesus in the New. Verse 32, "He'll be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High." Now, for most people, for most women, that would be great news. You're pregnant. That's great news, isn't it? Except every once in a while, it's a surprise. But for most married women, that would be great news. You are pregnant. The problem is, there's a problem, right? The problem is, and let me back up just a little bit. For a young Jewish woman, this would be the most wonderful news they would ever receive, because every young Jewish woman one day wanted to be the mother of the Messiah, okay? Wanted to be the mother of the one who was promised, every single one of them. And you know what? That's why there were so many young boys when they were born, there were so many who were called Jesus. Did you know that Jesus was not the only one named Jesus? There were many, many, many named Joshua or named Jesus. Everyone wanted to be the mother of the Messiah and hoped that their child would be. And here comes the angel, and Mary receives the announcement. Now, wouldn't that be wonderful? But Mary is confused and disturbed. Why? Luke 1, 34 through 38. She says, "But how can this happen? I'm a virgin." Okay, so first of all, it's impossible. And the angel replies, and the angel explains, this is how it will happen. The baby to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. Now stop right there, and I want us to think about this just a minute. And I want you to think about what this would mean to Mary. Under any other circumstances, it would be great news. But this is a conservative Jewish culture, and sexual relations outside of marriage were punishable by what? Stoning. Death by stoning. That was the charge for sexual relationship outside of marriage. And Mary was not married. Was not married. Let's look at her response. What does Mary say? She responds, I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true. And I think we sometimes think, wow, that's so great. She gets to be the mother of Jesus. But I want us to think about the other part of that this morning. Because with her saying yes, there came a whole other list of things that would be very, very terrible indeed. Very, very terrible. So I want you to look at how Mary responds. And now let's switch over and let's look at Joseph. Let's look at the part about Joseph, and we find out about Joseph in Matthew. So in Matthew 1, 18 through 21, here's Jesus, the Messiah, was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. Before the marriage takes place, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, look at verse 19, and this tells us what we talked about earlier. Joseph, her fiancé, was a good man. Now, you know what that tells us? That means he would not have slept with her before marriage, even though they had a relationship, an engagement relationship that was as binding as marriage. He was a good man, and he did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. Do you know what some Bible versions say here instead of break the engagement? You can look at your Bibles. Do you know what it says instead of break the engagement? It says what? It uses a different word, much stronger. It uses the word divorce. That's right. It uses the word divorce. The engagement relationship was so binding, it was considered a divorce if it was broken. What could Joseph have done, and what did Joseph think initially? When Joseph found out Mary was pregnant, he knew first of all, he thought first of all, she has been unfaithful to me. I know I'm not the father. I have not slept with her. She's pregnant. That means she has broken the relationship that she had with me. She's an unfaithful woman. I will not marry her. And if Joseph had publicly divorced her and broken the engagement, do you know what would have happened? Everyone would have said, she's a wicked woman. She is there would have been terrible shame upon her and great scorn upon her. She might even have been kicked out. And so what does Joseph do? Joseph explains. Joseph receives the visit from the angel of the Lord. He appears in a dream, and the angel says, don't be afraid. Take Mary as your wife. And he explains everything. And she will have a son, and you're to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sin. Now, what is the response of Joseph? Because if Joseph chooses to continue the engagement, what will people think? You tell me. What will people think? Thank you, Christine. That's right. Joseph was the father. Joseph was a bad man. Joseph had a sexual relationship with a virgin before marriage. And the blame would fall on Joseph even more than on Mary at this point. What does Joseph do, and what is his response? Let's see. Matthew 1:24. When Joseph woke up, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded, and he took Mary as his wife. Okay, so here we see his response. Now let's put both of them together. How do they respond? And let's look at Mary and Joseph, the next slide. How do they respond? Mary says, I'm the Lord's servant. May everything you've said about me come true. What does Joseph do? He did as the angel of the Lord commanded, and he took Mary as his wife. I believe there's a gift of Christmas here. And to me, the gift that Mary and Joseph give at this point is the gift of obedience. It's a gift of obedience. They say yes. They say, in modern terms, okay. They say, I will do what God says to do. I will obey. even though it's going to cost them shame, even though there will be gossip throughout the village, even though it will ruin their reputations. It will. It would ruin their reputations. Both Mary and Joseph say yes to God. They obey God. To me, this is one of the gifts of Christmas, a gift of obedience. So I want to ask you this morning, you've got this sheet of paper with a gift on it. It's blank. Do you need to give God a gift of obedience? Is there something He's been saying to you? Is there something He's been talking to you about and you've not obeyed, but you know you should? You know He's still calling you to? Is that something that you could give as a gift to Jesus this Christmas? I'm not telling you what to do, but I'm saying, is the Holy Spirit talking to you about something? It may be something small, it may be something big, but if you haven't done it yet, what I can tell you is this: you haven't done it because to obey would cost you something, right? It would cost you something. What did it cost Jesus? What did it cost Jesus? Is that a gift this Christmas that you would give Jesus? But let's not stop there. I want to keep on going this morning. You say, are there other gifts? Are we going to talk about the wise men now? Nope, we're not going to talk about the wise men yet. I want us to talk about the shepherds for just a little bit. You say, the shepherds didn't give Jesus anything. They were poor shepherds, and they weren't prepared, and they were out on the hills keeping watch over their flocks by night when suddenly an angel of the Lord, I know it in the King James Version, I've read that every Christmas Eve from childhood until adulthood. Before we opened any Christmas presents, we would always sit around the Christmas tree, we would sing Christmas songs, and we would read the Christmas story in the King James Version. And so I know it so very well. Did the shepherds have any gifts to give Jesus? We would normally say, no, the shepherds didn't have any gifts. But let's see. Let's consider the shepherds, and let's look in chapter 2 of Luke, verses 8 through 14. We know this part of the story so well. It's at night. They're with their flocks. They're guarding them because there were lions. You say lions? Yes, there were lions. In Palestine at that time, there were wolves, there were other things, and there were thieves as well. And so they're out at night, and they're doing what they should do. The angel of the Lord appears to them. Who is this angel? Do we know? We don't have a name for it, but who is it probably? Who do you think? Stephen says, yes. Your mind was thinking somewhere else. The Bible doesn't tell us, but you know what? I'm guessing, I think it was Gabriel. I don't know, because Gabriel was the angel sent of God for the announcements. God used other angels. Gabriel, now don't say, Pastor Jennifer's preaching heresy. That's what I think. I don't know. And God doesn't tell us. So the angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They're terrified, but he tells them, don't be afraid. Or as we would say in Chinese, we did this in Sichuan when we went last year. Bu yao hai pa. That's what we say. And all the angels would stand there when we did this in the classrooms. That's what they would do. And they say, don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all the people. The Savior. Yes. The Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David, and you will recognize him by this sign. And then the angel is joined by other angels, a vast host of others, the armies of heaven. Ooh, I like that. That's the greatest army in the world, isn't it? The armies of heaven, God's angelic host. And they were praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased. What in the world could the shepherds give Jesus? How in the world will the shepherds respond? They're poor. They have nothing. Shepherding was the lowest job, just about. It was the lowest job. They're out there with the sheep. They don't have anything wrapped. No stores are open because it's the middle of the night. They have nothing to give. What are they going to give, and how are they going to respond? Well, let's see what happens next. Because first of all, I want you to see one other thing. First of all, look really carefully. Does the angel ask them, this sets up what comes next. Does the angel ask them to do anything? Look carefully. It may be implied, but does the angel ask them to do anything? Yes or no? Does the angel tell them, go find Jesus? Does he say that?
No.
He says, you'll find him, but the angel doesn't command. The angel doesn't say, go. The angel doesn't say, bring any gifts. The angel doesn't say, tell anybody. The angel just gives them the good news of Jesus. Now, what do we see? Let's look next. Luke 2, 15 through 20. And here, I think, we find the gifts of the shepherd. Let's look at it. The angels, when they returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. Was there any question on their part? Maybe it happened, maybe it didn't. Yes? No, they said, hey, let's go. God has told us about it, and I want to tell you something. Look at this just a minute. We see angels throughout the story of Christmas, don't we? Do any angels get worshiped? Yes or no? No. Did Joseph worship an angel? No. Did Mary worship an angel? No. Do the shepherds worship an angel? No. Who do the shepherds look at? They say, which God, which the Lord has told us about. And then we see they hurried to the village. They found them. There was the baby. After seeing him, oh, they don't bring any gift. What happens next? The shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the story were astonished. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. It was just as the angel had told them. So let me ask you, as you look at the response of the shepherds, and if we were to say the shepherds gave gifts to Jesus, what type of gifts did they give Jesus? Look at their overall response. What do you think? Anybody? Cindy? They praised God. Somebody else? Obedience, joy, what? They left their sheep, they gave time. Anybody else? They shared the news, didn't they? Sharing the news. They told everybody, not just their friends. They told everybody. Anything else? Sorry? Their effort, that's right. They put forth a lot of effort as well. That's right. Anything else as you look at this? I think all of these things are part of it. And for me, I would wrap it up in one gift, in one general gift. When I look at the shepherds, this is what I see. I see the gift of complete surrender, right? Complete abandonment, an unreserved response to the Lord. Do you see that? Do you see that? There was nothing half-hearted, was there? There was nothing, okay, yes, praise the Lord. What we see here is they say, let's go, and they all go. They hurried there. They didn't just take, they hurried there. They see him. They tell everybody. They glorify and they praise God for all they'd heard and seen. And what I love about what the shepherds give is that it's just everything. It's unreserved. It's not measured. It's not half-hearted. It's not reserved in any way. It's just an overflowing. They gave God. They gave God. I want to ask you, do you ever respond to the Lord in that way? I'm not saying being weird or crazy on a Sunday morning and jumping all over the place and doing that. That's not what I mean. That's not what I mean. Some of us might say, well, that's not my personality, Pastor Jennifer. I'm just a quiet person. I'm very reserved. I'm not talking about personality this morning. And I'm not even talking about necessarily an outward response. I'm talking about a heart response to the Lord. Have you responded to the Lord in that way? Or do you always think about it? Do you always say, well, I'll give you this, God, but not this? Or do you ever just say, Lord, I don't care. Lord, I'm yours. Lord, all that I have, all that I am, unreserved, all of my heart, overflowing, overflowing. Have you ever responded to the Lord in that way? God responded to you in that way. That's how God came to you. He came with everything. He came with His best. He came with all. He held nothing back. He didn't say, "They're wicked sinners, and some of them are going to hate my son Jesus, and some of them are going to despise him. Some of them are not going to accept, and so I'm going to reserve." No. God gave all He had, the very best, unreservedly to you and to me. And so I have a question for you this morning. Is that a gift that you need to give Jesus? Is it? I'm not telling you what to do, but I'm saying, is it something that the Holy Spirit is whispering to your heart? Is this your gift this Christmas? Let's not stop there, and let's look at the wise men this morning. Of course, we think about the wise men, and we look in Matthew 2, 1 and 2. You know, when we talk about the wise men, we always say, how many wise men were there?
Three. We three kings of Orient are.
Does the Bible tell us there were three? No. How many gifts were there?
Three.
How many wise men were there? No, we don't know. We don't. That's not a trick question. We always think one wise man, one gift, but we have no idea whether that's true or not. Do you know it is likely that there were many more than three? Because it would have been, they would have come from quite a distance. There was likely a very large group of them. They perhaps would have had soldiers with them because they were wealthy. They were carrying great wealth a long distance. They might have had servants with them. There might have been a large group of them. Were they kings? We three kings of Orient are. Were they kings? We don't know. Let's see. May? Do these three wise men have any crowns? Are they wearing any crowns?
No.
No. Okay, biblically accurate so far. Except the three wise men, I see even I'm saying it, the three wise men were not there the night that Jesus was born. Did you know that? It had to have been sometime later. You say, Pastor Jennifer, are you sure? I'm sure. But I don't want to take time this morning to talk about it. If you say, tell me, I'll tell you later. You come see me. But they were not there at the same time the shepherds were. But it's okay. I still like to, when I have my creche and my nativity scene, I always put the shepherds there also so we can get the whole picture. But they wouldn't have been there at the same time as a shepherd, because when they came, Joseph and Mary had already moved. They were in a house, and Jesus was already was no longer completely a newborn baby. He was a little bit older. So there are things. And by the way, and what were the names of the three wise men? Thank you. Gaspar, Balthazar, and Melchior, right? Does the Bible say that?
No.
Where did that come from? It came from people. That didn't come from the Bible. Some people even say we know where their bones are. Where did that come from? Didn't come from the Bible. We have all sorts of traditions, don't we? Sometimes you think, oh yes, but I've heard this and I've heard that. Let me encourage you, it's best to go to the Bible to find out. And so we don't know a lot about them. They came from the east. Ah, that must be China, right, Sylvia? There you go. Some of them are Chinese. Okay, we don't know that either. Although it's possible, because the Chinese system of astronomy was very well developed. But so were the Parthians and the Medes as well. There were other cultures that had very well-developed systems of astronomy. So we don't know all of those things. But what we do know is this. They came from eastern lands and they said, "Where is the newborn King of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him." And then what do we see as we're coming to a conclusion this morning? They interviewed with Herod. They went on their way. They followed the star, and when they saw that the star had stopped, they were filled with joy. You know why they were filled with joy? They knew we've come such a long distance, and we're going to see this new king that is born. Now look with me at verse 11. They entered the house. They saw the child with his mother. I don't want to step on anybody's toes this morning, but I do want to say something. Please listen very carefully. They bowed down and they worshiped him. We come from many church backgrounds, don't we? I want you to see something very clearly this morning. And like I said, I'm not trying to step on anybody's toes. Who is worshiped in this nativity scene? Who is worshiped?
Jesus.
Jesus and Jesus only. Is Mary worshiped?
No.
Was Mary blessed of God?
Yes.
Was Mary favored of God?
Yes.
Yes, she was. She was a godly woman, and God saw her heart, and God chose her. And God knew that that young girl would say yes to him and would be a good mother, a good earthly mother to Jesus. But I want you to see something this morning and understand, and may our response be the same as what we see in the Bible. Only Jesus is worshiped. Only Jesus is worshiped. And I'm not speaking against any church. I'm just saying this is what the Bible says, isn't it? This is what the Bible shows us. And they came. God led them. God brought them all the way. God could have spoken to them and say, worship the mother and the child, but he didn't. God put in their hearts truth. And they bowed down and they worshiped him. And then they opened their treasure chests and they gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So when we look at this, these gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and we come to a conclusion this morning, we look at these gifts and the gifts that they gave. They were giving gifts to a king. What did they know and what did they not know? The Bible's not very clear on that. What we do know is that the Holy Spirit spoke to their hearts in some way that they could understand, right? And that's what I love. God speaks your language. God can communicate with you in a way that you can understand. These men were not believers in God. They did not worship at Jerusalem. They were probably pagans. It's almost definitely true, sure. They were pagans. They did not worship the one true God. And they come, but God could speak their language. And when he spoke, they understood and they responded to truth. That's what God is looking for. And they bring gifts to him of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now, what are these three gifts? Those of us that have been in church a long time, we know very well the symbolism of these three gifts, don't we? Some others of us may say, I don't really know the symbolism. So let's look at these gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and at the gifts they brought. First of all, let's look at gold. We look at gold, and what do we see when we look at gold? Gold, from the Old Testament to the New, was always, it was associated with holiness, but it was also associated with royalty, with kingship. And gold was a gift for a king. And the gift of gold, many Bible commentators agree on these three symbolisms. The gift of gold to Jesus said what? Jesus is a king. Jesus is a king. That's what the gold says. It's a king. Jesus is a king. It was the gift of royalty. It was the gift of kingship. And it was very, very costly. It was one of the most costly elements, one of the most costly gifts that could ever be given. The second gift was frankincense. Sometimes it's also just called incense, but it means the same thing. And it's a gum that comes from the bark of a tree. And it was kind of glittering, and it had a very strong smell. In the Bible, frankincense with God's people, now it was sometimes used to perfume a woman's body before marriage or to put it in the marriage bed. It was sometimes used for that. But for God's people, from the Old Testament to the New, do you know what frankincense was used for? Only? Frankincense was used only in offerings given to God and incense that was burned to God. Only when you go back to the Old Testament and when God told his people, prepare this incense, and this incense you are to burn before me in the tabernacle, on the ark, on the table of incense. You are to burn this. It was special. It was made in part of frankincense, and it was only given to God. It was only used for God, and it was used with offerings that were burnt offerings and given to God. And so frankincense tells us what? It was a gift for God. It was deity. It was not of earth. It was of heaven. And a gift for a deity, a gift for God, and the gift of incense symbolizes that Jesus is God. Jesus is God. So he is a king, he is God, and then the final gift, the gift of myrrh. Myrrh also came from a tree that grew in Arabia. Frankincense was much, much more expensive. In fact, sometimes frankincense was of more value than gold even. It was so precious. Myrrh was also precious, not quite as precious as frankincense. And myrrh came from a small tree, and it could be used for perfume and for other things. But in the New Testament, myrrh was associated with one thing. And what was it? Death and mortality. Myrrh was used to prepare a body for burial. Those were the spices that the women brought to the tomb to prepare the body of Jesus. But he didn't need it because he was raised from the dead. But myrrh symbolizes, the gift of myrrh says what? Jesus is a man, and Jesus is our Redeemer. Jesus is our Redeemer. And a redeemer had to be a man, and a redeemer had to die. So as we come to a close this morning, I want you to look at these three gifts one more time. Let me pull it all together. Let me pull these gifts together. What do these three gifts say about Jesus? All the gifts are costly, and all of the gifts acknowledge who Jesus was. All of the gifts acknowledge Jesus is special. All of the gifts acknowledge Jesus is worthy and of value. And so as we come to a close this morning, go to the very last slide, the very last slide. They worship him. They give their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And then the very last slide this morning, the very last slide. What gift do you bring this morning? Do you give a gift to Jesus? Do you give him what costs you nothing, what is very easy? The wise men, gave Jesus what was precious because they knew Jesus was of value. What do you give him? Is it a value, or is it what is left over? Is it what is of little value to you, of little worth to you? Or do you give Jesus your best? The gifts of Christmas. We've looked at the Bible this morning, but now we come to a close. And if you'd like to write on this and bring it up here and put it under the tree, you may. If you'd like to write on it and keep it with you to remind yourself what gift you could bring to Jesus this Christmas. Because the gifts of Christmas are not just 2,000 years ago. The gifts of Christmas are 2014. Amen. Let's close in prayer this morning. Hallelujah.